to execute his just wrath against sinners. He's going to come and he's going to overturn the apple cart. That's what he's going to do. He's going to completely overturn the apple cart. He's coming in judgment. And how is God going to do this? Well, God doesn't just do stuff by saying abracadabra. That's not how God does stuff. He's going to use the Assyrians to do it, and then later he's going to use the Babylonians to do it. But God is coming in judgment against the present evil age. And that means Israel, but it also means the other nations. The status quo with the other nations is totally unacceptable as well. And in this passage, in Isaiah chapter 19, he pronounces God's judgment against Egypt. So for the first 15 chapters, it says God is coming like a warrior, and he's going to make war against Egypt. And what does that mean for Egypt? It means their economy is going to be ruined. Egypt is mostly centered up in the northern part, around the Nile Delta. Their whole economy is based on the Nile. So he's going to upturn their economy. Egypt is very proud of their wisdom. They are distinguished for their wisdom. God is going to come and render their wisdom foolish. What else is he going to do? He's going to eliminate their gods. The Egyptians, of course, are pagans. They worship their gods and goddesses. Their chief god, of course, was the sun, Amun-Re. The God of Israel is going to come and, you know, render those gods and goddesses futile. So he's coming in judgment against Egypt. But that's only his first work. After that, then, he's going to change things. He's going to change the future. The future is going to be different. That's what the prophet announces. The future is going to be different, and it's not because sinners are able to bring this about. It's because God is going to create a different future. So God's coming in judgment against the present evil age, and then he's going to bring about the age to come. And the prophets talk about this age to come in a lot of different ways. But basically, it's a radical reversal of the present evil age. So you name the problem. The future age is going to reverse that. So at the heart of it, for example, is right now the Egyptians worship other gods. In that day, they're going to worship the God of Israel. Huh, that's unbelievable. What are you talking about? So we want to hear this passage in all of its BC-ness. Isaiah is a BC prophet, and he's making promises about the future, but he's saying it in a very much of a BC way. When the fulfillment comes, typically the fulfillment comes in a way that's even greater than the promise. It's even greater and deeper than the promise itself. So you want to understand these promises as in all of their BC situation. Now, what's the situation? We're about 700 BC. Assyria is moving, and their major opponent is Egypt. These are the two big powers. So basically, it's like this. Here's Egypt, and here's the Persian Gulf, and here's Assyria, northern Tigris River. These are big rivers. I had a chance one summer to be on an archaeological dig in northern Syria. and I got to see the Euphrates. This is big. This is a big Mississippi type of river. These are big rivers. And Assyria is on the move west. And what do they want? They want all of this territory, including the land of Israel. They want to control the sea trade and the Mediterranean. But Egypt won't let them. Egypt is their major antithesis. So basically, Israel is caught in the middle here between this tug of war between Mesopotamia and Egypt. All right. So Assyria and Egypt are radical opponents. That's the situation. All right. So Isaiah announces God is going to come in judgment against Egypt, but then he's going to do a new thing. He's going to bring in this age to come where things will be different. And this is where our text begins. So look at the sheet, starting verse 16. And and notice what, I'll give you a minute to read through the whole passage from verse 16 to verse 25. And I want you to tell me what expression gets repeated. That the Yahweh Tzavaoth gets repeated. What else? Pardon me? In that day. Let's track the phrase in that day. The phrase in that day, B'yom Hahu, synchronizes the following with the preceding. That's all it does. It's a synchronizing device. It means that the following is going to happen at the same time as the preceding. So A is going to happen, and at the same time, B is going to happen, and at the same time, C is going to happen. And where does that phrase, in that day, occur? Verse 16, where else? 18, where else? 19, where else? 23, and then where else? 24. So you have, it begins the sentence, in five places. Those mark the five paragraphs. So I can now delineate the passage into paragraphs. You got to think in terms of paragraphs. Read prophetic speech as paragraphs. All right. So verses 16 to 17 is one paragraph. 18 is another paragraph. 19 to 22 is the third. 23 is the fourth, 24 to 25 is the fifth. All right? Five paragraphs. Now, each paragraph sets forth its own scenario. Its own scenario. Each paragraph is kind of making its own point. So it's a gradual, incremental building up. At that time, apples is going to happen, and at that time, oranges is going to happen, and at that time, bananas is going to happen. It gradually builds it up, and then at the end, you have a fruit bowl. But he just kind of went piece by piece. This is the standard way of talking about the future. They'll project scenarios on the screen of the future. Scenarios. Here's scenario A, and here's scenario B. They're like little movie clips Here's a little movie clip, and here's a little movie clip, and here's a little movie clip. That's kind of how it works. And he wants you, the hearer, to picture it. So he depicts it. He wants you to kind of imagine that different future that God is going to produce. So it's very visual. It's very visual. It's not prosaic. Now, I organized it into lines. This technically is not Hebrew poetry, but it has kind of a poetic feel to it. It's kind of a combination of prose and poetry. It's kind of in the middle. So what I want you to do is read the first scenario, verses 16 to 17, and I want you to tell me if you see any overlap between verse 16 and verse 17. And I'll have each table do this. So we're going to have kind of some small group work here. Don't worry, I won't make you hold hands and sing kumbaya. But let's let each table, I want each table to talk about where are the overlaps between verses 16 to 17. I'll give you a couple minutes for that, okay? Okay, so what did you get? What overlaps do you see between verses 16 and 17? Any table?
Dread
Right. So that to be in dread, verse 16, to be in dread, verse 17, the same word gets repeated. What else? Right. So Egypt will become, and then in verse 17, this will happen to Egypt. Others. Right. This relative clause, which he is elevating over it, which he is planning against it, the it referring to Egypt. Others. The second to the last clause, from before the elevating forearm of Yahweh, from before the plan of Yahweh. Those two lines parallel each other. You see how he's doing doublets? He's pairing lines. Sometimes he'll pair the lines right next to each other. Sometimes he'll pair the lines between verses. So they like this pairing. Notice the second line. It will tremble, Egypt will tremble and be in dread. Verse 16, the second line in verse 17, everyone to whom one mentions her will be in dread. This being in dread. So the two sentences are very parallel, right? Verse 16 and verse 17, they're very parallel. What does this mean hermeneutically? It means that they can kind of interpret each other. They can help us explain each other. So verse 17 kind of clarifies. He's referring to the plan of Yahweh against Egypt. Yes. Good question. So now let's look at the lines individually. Egypt is the target, and in that coming day, Egypt will become like women. This is a simile. A will become like B. So now we have to ask, in what sense is he saying that? And what does that mean, like? Yes.
Women are very much victimized by war, by the warriors that come through. They're devastated. They've got children to take care of, and they can't because the resources aren't there. It's more than just the fear.
Okay. So he's using a simile, and how will Egypt become like women? So I get out the concordance, and I see, you know, what is the point of comparison? And it focuses on fear and lack of courage before stronger armies. You have a lot of passages in Jeremiah that use this simile, one in Nahum chapter 3 that uses this simile. So you can just look up the word women in your concordance and see if there are similar examples of making this comparison. So the idea is the women are vulnerable, they're helpless before the oncoming army, heavily armed soldiers, and the women are shaking. That's the point of comparison. Now, I like to always add these biblical writers kind of, they're generalizing, and I like to call it kind of the 80% rule. All things being equal, 80% of the time, women would be shaking in their boots before an incoming army. Now, there are always exceptions. There's your military woman who's going to, you know, fight back. But generally speaking, 80% of the time, this would be a generalization. He doesn't mean any disrespect for women. He's just talking about the way things typically are. All right, so Egypt is going to be like women. How so? They're going to tremble and be in dread in front of this coming disaster. Only what's the coming disaster? It's the elevating of the forearm of Yahweh of hosts. What does the word Yahweh of hosts mean? What does the word hosts mean? That's right, armies. So the picture is Yahweh is the commander-in-chief of the host of heavenly angels. He has this huge heavenly army. Angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, this huge army. And he's the commander-in-chief. You remember that story with, Elisha? And they were surrounded by the enemy, and the person, his assistant thought, we're going to get creamed. And then Elisha prayed, Lord, open his eyes. And he looked around and he saw the hills filled with angels. And he said, oh, man, we're going to mop up, you know. God fights in these wars. It wasn't just Israel fighting in these wars. God was fighting in a hidden sort of way and with his heavenly army. That's the picture. So it's a military picture. Yahweh in his army is coming against Egypt. What is that phrase, the elevating of the forearm? First of all, it's typically translated, yad is typically translated hand, but it doesn't really mean the hand, it means the forearm. And it's that. And the word elevating, it's the word nuf. A lot of times that's translated wave, as in a wave offering. But you would not have access to this information, but there was a good study done. And he shows that actually it means to elevate. Instead of a wave offering, they would elevate it. And but here, it's not referring to an offering. Here it's used in a secular sense. So this is a good illustration. Avoid illegitimate totality transfer. Illegitimate totality transfer is thinking that a word always has all of its meanings every time it's used. No, a word can mean different things, and it can be used in different ways. And here it's not referring to a priest elevating an offering. Here it's used in a secular way. It's talking about Yahweh's elevating arm in order to smite. He's going to smite Egypt. And Egypt is shaking in their boots. That's the picture. So the God of Israel is coming against Egypt. And they'll be in terror. How is that the reverse of the status quo? That's what's going to happen in the age to come. How is that the reverse of the status quo? The future is going to be different than the way things are now. Exactly. In the status quo, people are afraid of Egypt. They're the big power, they in Assyria. They're used to the ones, they're used to being the ones who bring terror. But in that day, reversal. Egypt is going to be shaken. And how does Egypt, how else is the reversal? Right.
And of course, you never get a statue of Yahweh, but it seems to me there's a kind of a counterpart there. I don't know if the Assyrians or the Egyptian head gods, you know, ever had their arm in the air and their statue.
Yeah. Well, certainly it evokes that image of Baal. They're not used to thinking of the God of Israel this way. Egypt is used to honoring their own gods. They're used to not giving, you know, a thought about the God of Israel, right? We have our own gods. We're not going to worry about your God. That's the status quo. And in that day, the God of Israel is the one who's going to terrify them. They're going to be shaking in front of the God of Israel. They're not used to doing that. So verse 16 is a reversal of the status quo. And verse 17, the land of Judah is going to become a source of reeling. Right now, Egypt thinks nothing of the land of Judah. Why is the land of Judah now going to become this source of reeling to Egypt? And the answer is because of their God. Judah and the Yahweh go together. And because of the God of Judah, therefore even the land of Judah is going to wreak terror. Now the next line, if you'll look at that in Hebrew, everyone who he will mention, this is a hifil of Zakar, it means to cause the other person to remember, cause the other person to remember, to make mention. And everyone who will mention her, every time you have a pronoun, you got to find the antecedent. The her here is the land of Judah. The land is a feminine. Everyone who will mention the land of Judah to him. So now you got to figure out how does that to him fit in. This is a good example of a resumptive pronoun. The to him goes back to the everyone, Cole. So everyone to whom one mentions the land of Judah will be in dread. That's the sentence. Talking about every Egyptian will be in dread from before the plan of Yahweh of hosts. This brings up the topic of the plan of Yahweh, which is big in Isaiah. We don't have a chance to talk about it. But take a look at just one passage. Look at chapter 14, verse 26. Egypt is used to carrying out its own plans. The nations are used to carrying out their own plans. But Isaiah says, in that day, Yahweh is going to carry out his plan. And his plan is going to trump. So 14, verse 26. This is the plan which has been planned against all the earth. This is the hand that has been outstretched against all nations. For Yahweh has planned it, and who will thwart it? No one. His hand is outstretched. Who will turn it back? No one. Yahweh's plan is what's going to happen, not the plan of the nations. This is a common emphasis in the book of Isaiah. The God of Israel is the one in charge, not the nations. Of course, everybody thought the nations were in charge. Assyria and Egypt are in charge. They're the big guns. And the prophet says, no, the God of Israel and his plan is what's going to happen. So, and his plan is going to be spelled out. But it begins by forcing Egypt to have to deal with the God of Israel. Okay. That's verses 16 to 17. That's scenario 1. Now I want you to look at scenario 2, verse 18, and tell me how scenario 2 is the reverse of the status quo. All right, I'll give you a couple minutes. How is scenario 2 the reverse of the status quo? You can talk about that at your tables. Okay, how is verse 18 a reversal of the status quo at the time of Isaiah? What you get?
God's going to come out of the forefront in major cities, and the pagan God will be somewhere off the wall like Jehovah's Witnesses.
Okay. The God of Israel becomes dominant, and the God of Egypt gets kind of sidelined, marginalized. What does this mean that five cities will swear to Yahweh? That doesn't mean they'll swear by Yahweh as an oath. It means they will swear allegiance to the God of Israel. So, in the status quo, no Egyptian city belongs to Yahweh. But in that day, five Egyptian cities are going to swear allegiance to the God of Israel. In the status quo, all the Egyptian cities honor the sun god. In that day, only one will be honoring the sun god. He's just kind of reversing it. Now, I'll talk a little bit more about that expression, the city of the sun. But I think what he's referring to is that that's all, typically Egypt honored the sun. That's going to only be city.
What do you make of the variant there, city of destruction?
Right, and so that's what I wanted to talk about. So if you look at the Hebrew, it says, city of Harris will be said with respect to one. And the one there is feminine, that's referring to the city. Harris in Hebrew means destruction. But there's a footnote on the, there's a flag on the play, a footnote. And you look down at the bottom and you see there's a good variant. Qumran, the great Isaiah scroll from Qumran. This Isaiah scroll dates to 125 B.C. It's the great Isaiah scroll. And, oh, by the way, it has all 66 chapters. So whoever copied that didn't know there was a second Isaiah. Stupid Qumran scribe, don't you realize there were five Isaiahs? Man, were you stupid back in those days. And that has, along with some other manuscripts and with some translations, that has Ha Keres with a Kath. And that means the sun. So the Qumran variant has it the city of the sun. The Hebrew has the city of destruction. So you could just follow the Masoretic text and say city of destruction. But I think he might be doing a play on that. And so it's the city of the sun, but that's also to be destroyed. At any rate, that's one of those textual critical variants. Do you go with the Qumran reading or the MT reading? And here I'm going with the Qumran reading, but that might be wrong. It's a flip of a coin. All right, so that's maybe the, you could argue either way. At any rate, he's clearly saying in verse 18, now five cities are going to be dedicated to the God of Israel, and they're even going to speak the tongue, the lip, the safa of Canaan, which would be a Canaanite language. Of course, that's referring to Hebrew. Hebrew fits into the category Canaanite languages. And over the years, we have found inscriptions. So Ugaritic, Edomite, Ammonite, Moabite, Phoenician, and Hebrew. They're all basically the same category. We label it Northwest Semitic. And it's basically labeled the Canaanite language. Hebrew here the reference would be Hebrew. So I like to tell my beginning Hebrew students that you can put on your resume foreign languages, Hebrew, Edomite, Moabite, Ammonite, and Phoenician. Put that on your resume, because once you know Hebrew, you know Edomite, Moabite, and Ammonite. They're all dead languages. That's the problem. Does anybody speak these languages? No, but it looks good on the resume. So that's amazing. In that day, five cities of Egypt are going to speak Hebrew and dedicate themselves to the God of Israel. You see how every scenario reverses the status quo. All right, third scenario. This is a complex scenario, verses 19 to 22. So I want you at your tables to delineate the ways in which verses 19 to 22 picture a reversal in the future of the way things are now. And there are several points of comparison.
Thank you.
Okay, let's talk about verses 19 to 22. So, third scenario, he's projecting a third movie clip on the screen of the future. That's how to picture it. And the future is going to be different than the way it is now in Egypt. So in that day, right in the middle of the land of Egypt, there's going to be an altar dedicated to Yahweh. What does that mean that it's in the middle of the land of Egypt?
Not just on the periphery.
Not just on the periphery. Central. Egypt is focused, is centered in the worship of Yahweh. And a standing stone at the border dedicated to Yahweh. What does that mean?
Is that like the stones they would erect in memory of significant occasions?
Yeah, so the standing stone... Why reference a standing stone? One possibility is Egypt was known as the land of obelisks. And in that day, they'll set up an obelisk to Yahweh. But why do it at the border? Pardon me? Yeah. When people enter into the land of Egypt. Right off the bat, they see this land is dedicated to the God of Israel. So, in the middle of Egypt's going to be a testimony to the God of Israel, and right at the border. Right, right. And one commentator suggested Egypt's going to be kind of another holy land. Right. And verse 20, it. Now, every pronoun has to have an antecedent. You always got to ask, what's the antecedent? I take it that the it is referring to the altar. The altar will become a sign and a witness to Yahweh of hosts in the land of the Egyptians. This evokes the book of Genesis, remember where the patriarchs would set up altars in commemoration when Yahweh would appear, and they'd set up an altar. So it's kind of evoking the time of the patriarchs. And when they, namely the Egyptians, cry out to Yahweh, what does that mean to cry out? Za'ak. Check the dictionary. To cry out for help. Commonly used in the Psalms. To cry out for help to Yahweh from before oppressors, that he, Yahweh, would send to them a Savior and one who would contend with the oppressor. Then he will deliver them. I take it the he there is could refer to the Savior or contender, but I take it as Yahweh. What does that sentence evoke? What time in the life of Israel do you think of? Well, when would Israel cry out from before their oppressors and God would send them a Savior? Judges. Time of Judges. I think he's portraying Egypt in the future as having like a period of the judges. And he's not going to give Egypt a king. They don't get their own Egyptian king. So they don't have an Egyptian king, so it's going to be more like a pre-monarchical period. And I think that's how he's picturing it. And so when they're afflicted, they'll cry out to Yahweh, and he'll send them a Savior and a contender. In the book of Judges, it usually says God will raise up a Savior. You know, those would be the judges. Here it says God will send them. The judge is, the Savior is not going to be a native Egyptian. In Israel, when God would raise up a judge, a savior. It was always a native Israelite. So I think that verb send here is used intentionally. This is going to be someone from the outside who's going to be their savior and contender. All right. And then the next line, verse 21, what does this remind you of? What book of the Bible comes to mind in the Old Testament when it says, Yahweh will make himself known to Egypt, and the Egyptians will know Yahweh in that day? Yeah, but earlier, in the history of Israel, what book? The book of Exodus. It's commonly repeated in the book of Exodus. Yahweh reveals himself, makes himself known. The Egyptians will know that I am Yahweh. Remember how the whole book of Exodus kind of sets that up. Exodus 5. Moses comes before Pharaoh and says, thus says Yahweh, let my people go. And Pharaoh says, who's Yahweh? Never heard of him. I'm not about to let your people go. They're slave labor. They're building my buildings. You know, and then, so Pharaoh never heard of Yahweh, never heard of the God of Israel. I've heard of a lot of gods, but never heard of that God. And then Yahweh says, let me introduce myself. 10 plagues, wham, wham, wham. And after God is done, yeah, Pharaoh's heard of the God of Israel. So in that day, it'll be like the book of Exodus. The God of Israel will reveal himself to the Egyptians, only this time, not in punishment, this time in salvation. This time, the God of Israel is going to come as the gospel God, not as the law God that Egypt had to face in Exodus. So this is going to be pretty amazing. God will reveal himself to Egypt. It's a niphal. Niphal typically has this reflexive meaning, to make himself known. To make himself known. How did I get that? Look up in a grammar under niphal. What does a niphal do? And grammars typically tell you this. A good grammar is Waltke and O'Connor. Another good one is by Jouon, J-O-U-O-N. An old one is Gazanius Kauchkali. So you just check under niphal and see what the possibilities are. So Yahweh will make himself known to Egypt, that's a niphal, and as a result, notice the sequence. God, first of all, has to reveal himself. Then the Egyptians will know the God of Israel. They cannot by their own reason and strength believe on the God of Israel or come to him. They cannot by their own reason and strength know the God of Israel. First, the God of Israel has to make himself known, and then they'll know him, right? God takes the initiative. God's a good Lutheran. God takes the initiative, reveals himself, and then the Egyptians know the God of Israel. And then they will know, and they will serve. The word serve, typically, avad, typically means to worship. They will serve, worship Yahweh with sacrifice and grain offering, and they will vow to Yahweh, and they will actually complete those vows. This is an amazing verse. They're going to sacrifice, offer sacrifices and grain offerings. Where? Verse 20. Verse 19, on that altar in the midst of the land of Egypt. This is amazing. What's Isaiah saying? In the Old Testament, the only, in Isaiah's day, the place to offer the sacrifice was at the temple in Jerusalem. Solomon's temple, that's where you do it. But in this coming day, the Egyptians will even offer to the God of Israel on their own altar. The day is coming when you don't have to do it in Jerusalem. Unbelievable. What are you talking about, preacher man? And now, 2,700 years later, we're used to this. We have an altar even here in the ends of the earth, known as Grand Rapids, Michigan. The ends of the earth. But in Isaiah's day, only Jerusalem. So this is a pretty amazing promise. Egypt will have their own altar. All right. This future is going to be radically different. That's what he's saying. Radically different. And it's going to be brought about by the God of Israel. Humans are not going to produce this. Verse 22, and Yahweh will strike Egypt, repeatedly striking and healing, just like the book of Judges. And whenever they go astray, he's going to chastise them. And then when they return to Yahweh, he's going to heal them. And notice this verse at the end of verse 22. And Yahweh will allow himself to be entreated by the Egyptians, and he will heal them. So in verse 22, in the second line, he kind of summarizes the whole story. Then in the third line and fourth line, he unpacks that story. When they return and when they pray, he'll hear their prayer and heal them. This is notice that how I translated that. This is a niphal. It's called a tolerative niphal. How did I get that? Look it up in a grammar under niphal. A niphal can often mean to allow yourself to be done this activity. So here, to allow himself to be entreated. God is going to willingly allow himself to be entreated, beseeched, and he'll answer those prayers, even by Egyptians, non-Israelites. God's going to hear, the God of Israel one day is going to hear the prayers of non-Israelites. One day he's going to hear the prayers of Gentiles. Unbelievable. Well, God has been fulfilling this for the last 2,000 years, and here we're a room full of Gentiles, and we're all praying to the God of Israel. And he's hearing our prayers through Jesus, his incarnate Son, Israel's Messiah. Okay, verse 23, fourth scenario. In that day, there'll be a highway from Egypt to Assyria. They'll easily go back and forth to each other, and Assyria will enter into Egypt, and Egypt will enter into Assyria. How is that a reversal? At the time of Isaiah, they're bitter enemies. They're bitter opponents. They're in this huge tug of war for the lands in the middle. But in that day, they're going to be reconciled. The God of Israel is going to reconcile enemies. And so Assyrians will freely go to Egypt, and the Egyptians will freely go to Assyria. There's going to be this huge reconciliation of enemies. And they together, Egypt together with Assyria, I take that as the preposition with, will serve. The implied direct object is Yahweh. It's Avad. So together, these bitter enemies, reconciled, will serve the God of Israel. That's an unbelievable promise. The bitter enemies now are going to be reconciled and worshiped the God of Israel. Wow! One day, the God of Israel is going to reconcile enemies to himself and to each other. That's amazing. The people who heard Isaiah must have thought, you're nuts, preacher man, you're nuts, you're talking utopia here, you're talking dreamland. Well, that's the promise. It's a completely different future. That's what the prophet is talking about. And the fifth scenario, and this is a phenomenal scenario, verses 24 to 25. The fifth scenario. In that day, Israel will be a third with respect to Egypt and Assyria. In other words, they'll actually be all three on the same level. All three on the same level. Israel is going to be a blessing, a barakah. I take that as a source of blessing in the midst of the earth. God's going to fulfill his promise to Abraham. Through Abraham and through his offspring, all the nations will be blessed. That comes via Israel. And I take this singular pronoun as referring to each one, each of whom Yahweh of hosts will have blessed by saying. And how does Yahweh bless? By saying the following. That's how he blesses. The speech actually accomplishes the blessing. When the pastor pronounces the Aaronic benediction, the utterance actually does the blessing. That's how the blessing happens, is through the words. And that's what's going on here. So he's going to bless each one by saying the following. And notice how radical this is. Blessed be Ami, my people, Egypt. Huh? What? Huh? Throughout the Old Testament, my people occurs hundreds of times, and it always means Israel. It always refers to Israel. It always refers to Israel. But here, the day is coming when that signifier is going to refer to Egypt. That's amazing. And blessed be the work of my hands, Assyria. Huh? Throughout the Old Testament, the work of my hands is always Assyria. God created Israel. God created Israel as his own people. But in that day, the work of his hands is going to be Assyria, and Israel will be my inheritance. What has he just done? He's just promoted Egypt and Assyria to the level of Israel. Egypt and Assyria are going to be at the same level as Israel. This is the BC way of saying, in Christ, Jew and Gentile are one. This is a phenomenal promise. In Isaiah's day, Assyria wanted to destroy Israel. That's what they were about. They took northern Israel into exile. They took Judah into exile, and they wanted to destroy Jerusalem. But in that day, Assyria is going to be the people of God. And Egypt, of course, just on the other side. This is so. That's a phenomenal promise. All right, let's wrap up. What have we seen? We've seen five scenarios, and they kind of go in an incremental progression. So the first scenario is Egypt's going to be shaken in their boots before the God of Israel. Da 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 da. The last scenario is Egypt is going to be adopted as God's own covenant people, right up there with Israel, right? So how does Isaiah portray the age of the future with scenarios? And you got to examine each scenario and the logic of that scenario. And you got to hear it from a BC perspective. Don't immediately go to the New Testament. Hear it in all of its BC-ishness. And then you can go to the New Testament and see how the fulfillment happened. And in Christ, we're all part of the one people of God, and we all, and a lot of us even learned Hebrew, the language of Canaan. And we worship the God of Israel through Jesus, Israel's Messiah. So, God has fulfilled this promise in an amazing way, and it even has fulfilled it to us, the ends of the earth. What has God been up to the last 2,000 years? Fulfilling these promises. That's what he's been doing. Bringing the Gentiles to himself. And you are part of the fulfillment. You're part of the fulfillment. Isaiah would be astonished to see a room of Gentiles learning about the God of Israel. That's the amazing thing God has been doing for 2,000 years. It doesn't make the newspapers, but it's amazing. And so we can study Isaiah to learn about God, to learn about Jesus, but also to learn about ourselves. That's the great book of Isaiah. He's been called the Shakespeare of the Bible, and rightly so. It's just wonderful. So I hope this helps you in your exegetical skills to kind of work through a text line by line and think about what is the prophet doing. Thank you very much. It's been a real joy to be with you.